Good evening, everybody. Thank you for all coming tonight. If you all would like to join me in singing tonight, we are singing Golden Beulahland, page 216, verses 1, 2, and 4. I mean, I like how y'all are standing. No, Tyler's giving me the signal over there, like, tell them to stand. I'm just like, no, they're standing on their own. They're doing fine. Page 216. And yes, please stand.
Strife upon my ear is falling, then I know the sins of earth beset on every hand. Doubt and fear and things of earth in vain to me are calling. None of these shall move me from Beulahland. I'm living on the mountain underneath the cloudless sky. I'm drinking at the fountain that never shall run dry. Oh yes, I'm feasting on the manna from a bountiful supply, for I am dwelling in Beulahland. Far below the storm, a doubt upon the world is beating. Sons of men in battle, all the enemy withstand. Safe am I within the castle, God's word retreating. Nothing then can reach me, 'tis Beulahland. I'm living on the mountain, underneath the cloudless sky. I'm drinking at the fountain that never shall run dry. Oh yes, I'm feasting on the manna from a bountiful supply, for I am dwelling in Beulahland. View and hear the works of God, I seek in contemplation. Hearing now his blessed voice, I see the way he planned. Dwelling in the Spirit, here I learn a full salvation. Gladly will I tarry in Beulahland. I'm living on the mountain, underneath the cloudless sky. I'm drinking at the fountain that never shall run dry. Oh yes, I'm feasting on the manna from a bountiful supply, for I am dwelling in Beulahland.
Oh, thank you for picking that up. I had a frog or something in my throat, and I was actually choking up. I was like, oh, I hope they pick up the slack on that. But thank you. We're going to turn to page 333, The Lily of the Valley, page 333. And I was going to give a welcome, but I think I'll just leave that to Pastor. He's got it. You're welcome.
I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. The fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The lily of the valley, in him alone I see all I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. In sorrow he's my comfort, in trouble he's my stay. He tells me every care on him to roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He all my grief has taken and all my sorrows borne. In temptation he's my strong and mighty tower. I have all for him forsaken and all my idols torn from my heart, and now he keeps me by his power. Through all the world forsake me and Satan tempts me sore, through Jesus I shall safely reach the goal. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me. Greater to my faith than to his blessed will. A wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna, he my hungry soul shall fill. Then sweeping up to glory to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
You in the house of God tonight. And we're going to go ahead and give some announcements. But while I'm getting ready to that, it might be somebody has a word for the Lord that they would like to say or give a testimony. If the Lord's been good to you and you just want to brag on him a little bit, I wonder maybe somebody's just got a quick testimony they'd like to share. Yes. You don't want your legs to roll. You want them to walk, though, right? Okay, good. Amen. Amen. Good. Praise the Lord. Yeah. Anybody else? All right, let's go to an announcement while you're thinking about that. On the 8th, we got our focus night. That's next week, and that'll be at 6:30, so please be mindful of that and be in your place. August the 14th, Primetimers are having a birthday bash, and that will be at 2 o'clock here at the church. And it's for all the birthdays all year. Also on the 28th, we are kicking off our end of summer blast for kids 4 to 12. And there's flyers on the welcome table. So if you want to take some of those and pass those out to some of the kids that you know that fit that age group, we want to be inviting them to that and kind of build the junior church along with Sunday school with that program. And so the time will be 12 to 3 p.m. It's going to be a good day. They're planning lots of activities. And then also, if you're willing to work at that, please sign up. There's a sign-up sheet in the back. You can participate and be a blessing there. On August the 29th, we're going to have Pastor Garth Hutchison with us, and that'll be a combined Sunday school, morning service, and evening. That'll be August the 29th, and so be prepared for that. And then I have a sign-up sheet for Lawn Crew on the side table there. So if you're willing to be a part of that, we want to have all those numbers, names and numbers listed there so that we can get a crew, and maybe we could fluctuate between who does that every week. And many hands make light work. And so be mindful of that opportunity as well. And then also a couple of urgent prayer requests. Pray for Brother Doug Kennedy. He had his other leg amputated, and so just pray for his recovery process, the rehabilitation process, and then being relocated back to Prescott, Michigan with Doug Jr., and that's what they're looking at right now. They think that probably will be the best scenario, and I do as well, to be close by family there, and so pray for that situation. He's in good spirits right now. I talked to him yesterday, and so continue to pray. And then the Amster family, Jeremy Amster, passed away this past week. That's Mike Mueller's son-in-law, who was married to Amanda. And the funeral service will be at Prairie Baptist Church on Tuesday at 11 o'clock. If you're able to be there and just be an encouragement to the Muellers, I'm sure that would be a help and a blessing as well. I think that's all the announcements that we have. And any other testimonies that we have before we get on with our preaching tonight? Don't want to rush through it, or anybody got a word? Yes, ma'am. Amen. Amen. Good. Praise the Lord. Yes, ma'am. Mm-hmm. Well, praise the Lord for God's protection. Amen. Amen. Miss Lee? Amen. I love God's provision. Amen. Praise the Lord. It's good. That just pocket change for him. Amen. All right. Pastor Tyler, come ahead and we'll open our Bibles up to Genesis chapter number 12. Is that right? All right.
Genesis chapter number 12. I want to welcome everyone here. It has been quite the weekend. And we're glad it's done. We are glad that we had everyone come back that left with us. And so, yeah, we did have a little trip to Lake Michigan. And we're thankful also for Colin Stuck. He's not here. I told the teens that they didn't have to come Sunday night because we had a long weekend. But Colin helped Rachel while she was struggling in Lake Michigan. So thankful for that and that everyone had a good time. And that we enjoyed it, had some good devotionals with the young people, really just a good time away, and had really just a blast. Again, Nate and Christina, they're on vacation now, but they were with us for the first half. Appreciated them and their willingness to go, and they said they look forward to next year when they're able to go to the whole thing. And I thought that this year did go very well. We're looking forward to doing it again next year. Personally, I thought it was better than going to Camp Kobiak. And you say, oh, Pastor Tyler, you're just partial. All the teens said they liked going there better than Camp Kobiak. They had a little more freedom. It wasn't quite as a strict schedule. They got to sleep in a little bit more, which I know the guys definitely took advantage of. I'm pretty sure the girls didn't sleep at all. They were in another cabin, and I kept telling them, right, they need to be at the guy's house for breakfast at 9 o'clock. And there they are, 8:30, showing up at our door. We're ready to come in. I said, we're still asleep. Half the guys aren't even up yet. But we had a great time, and I want to thank everyone that was able to go and be a part. And we do look forward to doing it again. Genesis chapter number 12. We will continue on with where we left off last week. Last week we were kind of just in the first three verses giving some background to the differences between chapters 1 through 11 and where God is going to pick up with Abraham. And the reason God divides the book of Genesis up in that. He gives us the first 11 chapters to show the ongoing battle that is going to transpire throughout all of history, how God moves and Satan counters, and Satan moves and God counters. Abraham is the beginning of the fulfillment of the prophecy of Genesis 3:15, when he gives the prophecy that the seed of the woman will crush the serpent's head. That ultimately happens with Jesus Christ, but it starts right here with Abraham. And so you see that division of chapters 1 through 11 and 22 through 50. And so now we are getting into the life of the very first patriarch, Abraham. And so we looked at that. We looked a little bit at the name changing from Abram to Abraham, from Sarai to Sarah, and the importance that that has. It shows the new life in Christ for the believer now. That's how we can take that away. We no longer are slaves to our old nature. We still fight it and we still battle it, but we have victory through the new man that God has given to us. When Abram fully dedicated his life to Christ, God said, you're no longer Abram, you are Abraham, father of many nations. And so we looked at that, and now we're going to get into a little bit of the actual nitty-gritty of Abraham's life. And it actually starts a little less glamorous than you might think. We tend to look at Abraham and be like, man, what a man of faith that he was to get out of his own country and just follow God blindly to the land that he would call him to. But it wasn't that simple for Abraham. There were some hiccups and there was some doubts along the way that we're going to get into. So Genesis chapter number 12, we're going to look at his believing, the belief that Abraham had. And we're going to read verses 1 through 9 for our text this evening. Starting in verse 1, now the Lord had said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country, and from thy kindred, and from thy father's house, unto a land that I will show thee. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee, and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee, and in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. So Abram departed as the Lord had spoken unto him, and Lot went with him. And Abram was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran. And Abram took Sarai his wife, and Lot his brother's son, and all their substance that they had gathered, and the souls that they had gotten in Haran. And they went forth to go into the land of Canaan, and into the land of Canaan they came. And Abram passed through the land unto the place of Sichem, or Shechem, unto the plain of Morah, and the Canaanite was then in the land. And the Lord appeared unto Abram, and said, Unto thy seed will I give this land. And there builded he an altar unto the Lord, who appeared unto him. And he removed from thence unto a mountain on the east of Bethel, and pitched his tent, having Bethel on the west, and Hai on the east. And there he builded an altar unto the Lord, and called upon the name of the Lord. And Abram journeyed, going on still toward the south. And so we're getting into this story, and I got a map up there. I don't know if you're going to be able to see it very well, but this is the migration pattern that Abram would have taken. You see the red line. There's also a dotted red line. That is the possible alternate route that he could have taken. We know certain places on the map where he stopped and where the Bible mentions specifically. Starting on the right of the screen at the very first dot, there's Ur. Right, and Abram was from the land of Ur, and we actually see that the first call for Abram was in the land of Ur. What was that? Oh, Facebook crowd. I'm sorry, this screen might be better. You see Ur there at the bottom. You also see a little block there. You should see it on your screen. No problem. But yeah, it is on this side of me. I'm like a showcase person here. But you see that. So Ur is the beginning. That is where Abram starts. That's the first call that Abram receives. And he comes up out of the land of Ur, out of the land of his fathers, and he begins his migration. But you notice, if you know anything about the Middle East area, that Israel is a small country right along the Mediterranean Sea. You'll see at the bottom of the red line, Shechem, Bethel, Hebron, Jerusalem. They're all together. That's the promised land. That's Canaan, where Abram was supposed to be. That's where God wanted him to be. But notice he takes this huge detour up and then slowly starts to come down. Right? That's Abram's migration pattern. And his believing at the beginning was actually quite weak. He had weak faith. We want to compare this with Genesis chapter number 11, the chapter previous. It says, In Terah took Abram his son, and Lot the son of Haran his son's son, and Sarai his daughter-in-law, his son Abram's wife, and they went forth with them from Ur of the Chaldees to go into the land of Canaan. And they came unto Haran and dwelt there. So in Genesis chapter number 11, Abram is the one that receives the call to get thee up out of the land of thy fathers and of thy forefathers, out of Ur of the Chaldees, and go to the land that I will tell you. But who is the one making the choice to migrate in chapter 11, verse 31? It's Terah. Not Abram. His grandfather, Terah, makes the choice and makes the decision. And so Abram didn't leave his kindred or his father's house. He just moved upriver with them. Look what God had told him to do in verse number 1. Get thee out of thy country, from thy kindred, and from thy father's house, unto a land that I will show thee. Abram, his first thing that he was supposed to do was separate. Separate so that God could use him and have full control over his life. But we see, because of the weak faith of Abraham at the beginning, he doesn't quite follow all the way. He does move. We do see there is some obedience, but it's not total or complete obedience. There's still some bonds that hold him captive. And we're going to see that this is going to cause him some trouble, mainly with the nephew that he brings along. We want to think about the problem that he has with Lot. Right? He takes Lot up with him, and literally he's up a creek without a paddle, is what we have. Abram gets into quite a bit of trouble because of Lot. Lot causes him issues. Not just with when he moves with Sodom and Gomorrah. There's actually a moment where Lot and his family, they get kidnapped by some men, and Abram and his trained servants have to go and fight a battle in order to win Lot back. So Lot ends up causing him quite the delay and quite the problems a little further along. Now, before we start to judge Abraham or Abram too hard, we should understand that this would be a hard move for anyone, right? For God to call Abram and say, forsake everything that you know and go to a place that I'm going to tell you, but I'm not going to tell you up front. I'll tell you when you get there. Right? If I was to go to you and say, all right, uproot from everyone you know, from everything you've ever known, and just start driving. And when the time's right, I'll call you on your cell phone, and I'll let you know when you can stop. Right? I'm pretty sure every single one of you would say, nope, not going to happen. Abraham would have also had these reservations, so it should be commended that he does take the initial step of moving. Right? Because there's a lot of Christians who wouldn't have even moved in the first place. Right? And I think there's a good illustration with this with missionaries that are called to the mission field now. These are people that literally have the call of God on their life, and much like Abraham, have to leave everything that they've known, the comforts of the United States, the comforts of family, and a home church that is loving, and go to sometimes a country that is not very friendly to the gospel, where their lives can literally be endangered just for being there. And if they find out that they're preaching the gospel and trying to start a church, they could literally lose their lives or be imprisoned for doing that. And so they have a calling very much like Abraham, where they have to get up and go into the unknown, not knowing what's going to happen. But that's a difficult choice. And it sometimes is a difficult choice to follow God. But Abraham does it, but he does it half-heartedly at the beginning. It's interesting, the two men in Abram's life, his grandfather and his father, mentioned by name, the first one being Terah, the next being Haran. Interesting, Pastor Hutchinson, he was kind of getting ahead of me last week. I had finished my message, and he came up to me and he said, Pastor Tyler, I was saying, do you know what those names mean? I was like, yeah, I'm getting into that next week. But we were having a conversation about it. Terah means delay. Delay. Haran means parched. And so these figures in Abram's life that he literally cannot separate from, he goes with them, they cause him delay and parched, right? When that is when you don't have enough water and you begin to be thirsty. That is an appropriate name because Abraham does not receive an appearance from God. I'm getting a little ahead. I'll mention this a little later. He doesn't get an appearance from God until he fully separates from his family and from his kindred and makes it to the land that God had promised him. Right? So there's a delay in the call and in the movement, and there's parched. There's not the same connection with God as he's in a state of incomplete obedience. And if you remember the map, remember, he could have just went, Bob, if you want to pull that map up one more time, you can kind of see from Ur of the Chaldees, let me go to this side again, it would have been much simpler to just go west and go to Shechem. Walk the straight line. But no, they go all the way up to Haran, which is at the very top of the map. If you want to find that, you see Pada Aram, and Haran is right above that, where the red and the dotted red line meet. That's Haran, where Abram actually will start leaving his family. His father, Haran, dies there, and Abraham then forsakes and starts to now make his migration south. Interesting that when he's not in complete obedience, he's heading north, the opposite direction of where God wanted him. But as soon as he starts to follow in obedience, he begins to come south, which is the direction that God wanted him to go. He starts getting a more clear picture of where he was supposed to meet. And then Shechem, Bethel, Hebron, Jerusalem, Beersheba, these are all in the land of Canaan where he was supposed to be. And so Terah means delay, Haran means parched. We see that those names become very applicable to the path that Abram takes. Now, Abram's failure isn't quite apparent at this point, right? We don't think of Abraham as a failure. In fact, many people wouldn't have even stopped to notice that the fact that he went with his father and his grandfather was a bad thing. Because all throughout the rest of Scripture, God speaks very highly of Abraham and his move and what faith it took. And so Abram's failure isn't apparent at this point, but at the point that we get right, or Abraham gets right and begins to move, God remembers our sin no more. And this is actually a very encouraging moment, because as much as his faith was shaky and his faith was small at this point, throughout the rest of Scripture, God is going to remember Abraham as a man of great faith, that when God called, Abram obeyed. We got several verses that I want us to read, starting in Hebrews chapter 11, a very fitting chapter. Hebrews 11, 8, by faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should receive, called to go out into a place which he should after receive for an inheritance, obeyed. And he went out not knowing whither he went. Hebrews chapter number 8, verse 12, for I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 17, and their sins and iniquities will I remember no more. Acts chapter 7, 2 through 4, this is them remembering the story of Abraham. And he said, men and brethren and fathers, hearken, the God of glory appeared unto our father Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia, before he dwelt in Charan. He said unto them, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred, and come into the land which I shall show thee. Then came he out of the land of the Chaldeans and dwelt in Charan. From thence, when his father was dead, he removed him into this land wherein ye now dwell. Psalm 103, verse 12, as far as the east is from the west, so far hath he removed our transgressions from us. 2 Corinthians chapter number 8, verse 12, for if there be first a willing mind, it is accepted according to that a man hath, and not according to that he hath not. And so this is an encouraging thing, because just as Abraham, even though he didn't start right and he didn't quite start with complete obedience, when he makes the decision to get it right, that's what God remembers afterwards. Abraham gets right with God and starts following in complete obedience, and that's how God remembers him now. We get the same blessing when God asks us to do something, even though we might fail at first. When we make the decision to get right, and when we repent, not ask for forgiveness, but actual repentance and turning from it, you know what God says? I remember those sins and iniquities no more. I've removed them as far as the east is from the west. God is more concerned with the right things that we do, not necessarily how we started. As soon as we follow the pathway that God has set for us, that's when God begins to bless, and that's what God remembers. It's interesting that so many people get caught up on their failures of their past. So many people will refuse to serve God because, oh, well, God would never use someone like me, and you don't know what I've done in my past, and there's no way that I can ever amount to anything for God. I was dealing with our small group on Mondays. We learned that that is guilt. It's not conviction. Guilt is from the devil for the sole purpose of discouraging you and defeating you in your fight. Conviction is of God to cause you to repentance of a very specific sin so that you can get it right, repent and move on and accomplish something. Abraham figured out that he needed to obey God wholeheartedly, got him up out of the land of his kindred, and followed after God. And now we remember him as the man of great faith. God remembers him as the man of great faith. There's no mention in Hebrews 11 of the fact that he went up north and he dwelt in Haran for a few years. No, Hebrews 11, 8 said, by faith, when he was called, obeyed and went forth. It's interesting. I did read Acts chapter number 7, and you might have noticed that that verse did mention Abraham's little detour. But that was mankind remembering the history of Abraham. Hebrews 11, 8 was God remembering Abraham's journey. And God didn't say, oh, I remember your little detour, Abraham. I remember how you weren't quite obedient to me. No, God says, by faith, he obeyed, and he went. And I think that's so encouraging for us. We get so caught up on our own failures or what other people might bring up about our past. And God's up in heaven saying, I have no idea what you're talking about. I've hidden those sins. I've thrown them away. As far as the east is from the west, he remembers them no more. Think about that. An omniscient God remembers your sin no more. That's one of those incomprehensible things that an all-knowing being could forget something. And yet that's exactly what he says about our failures. I think that is such an encouraging passage of Scripture for us as an individual moving forward in the work of Christ. So, continue looking at his believing. The move that he is asked to make is a move that requires great faith. And so, why does Abraham make the move? There must be something greater than his fear that motivated or prompted his faith to go forward. Right? I gave the illustration, if I told you to leave everything that you'd ever known or ever been around and go to a place that you didn't know, and when you get there, I'll tell you. You would say no. The only difference would be if I was, let's take a very wealthy man. Let's say I was Jeff Bezos. Everyone knows who Jeff Bezos is, the CEO, founder of Amazon. And I said, all right, same requirements. Get up, leave everything and everyone that you've ever known, and just start driving. And when I call you, set up camp right there and stay there. And if you do, I'll throw in $1 billion. Now we're thinking, okay, bye, Mom. Bye, Dad. I'll see you later. Because now there's incentive to get up and go. It prompts the movement. So this move requires great faith, and the thing that actually gets him moving is God's promise to Abram. God made a very significant promise to Abram or Abraham, and we're going to look at the seven I wills of Genesis chapter number 12, verse 2 through 3. Now, they don't all start with I will. Some of them are preceded by I will, and then it's two or three things after. But there's seven things that God promises Abraham. Verse 2 through 3, let's read it. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee, and make thy name great. And thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee. And in thee all families of the earth be blessed. And so the very first thing that he says, I will make of thee a great nation. This is a national blessing, right? God is promising that the seed and the descendancy of Abraham, God is going to make them something special. He's going to make them a great nation. And that has followed throughout history, especially in Bible times. The pinnacle and the highest point of Israel's kingdom would have been at King Solomon. He was the epitome. After David, David was a man after God's own heart. He rules for 40 years. He begins to accumulate materials for the temple. Solomon becomes the king. God offers Solomon anything that he would want. Solomon asks for wisdom so that he would be a good king, so that he could rightly govern the nation of Israel. And because of the good decision that Solomon made, we see that Israel had an unprecedented time of peace, an unprecedented time of wealth and fame. Solomon's fame and wisdom and the wealth of Israel was so vast and so well known that people from other countries would come and kneel down before Solomon just to see the glamour and the splendor of his kingdom and the wisdom with which he conducted Israel. Mentioned by name, the Queen of Sheba. She comes all the way just to behold Solomon and Israel's greatness. The temple that Solomon builds is one of the seven ancient wonders of the world. And if you were to actually go and see everything that was made and that was used and see the money that that would be in today's day and age, this building would have been spectacular. It would have been immaculate. So much so that when Babylon comes in and takes Judah captive, the temple is the place they go, and they ransack it, and they strip the gold and the marble that was there, because it was a very wealthy place, and it was a great spoil of war. And so Israel did become a great nation. Skip ahead after the captivity, Israel gets to come back, and they begin to start over again. We see Israel going through the New Testament. They are a place, but they're not quite a nation again. They're always under subjection by someone. Babylon took them captive. The Medo-Persian Empire under Cyrus the Great lets them go and lets them go back to their land. But before long, the Roman Empire comes, and they are putting them under subjection as well. It's not until, I believe it's 1948, that Israel actually becomes a sovereign nation again. And now we see all these Jews that have been scattered around the world start to converge back on their homeland, which is, by the way, their homeland, because God said it so. And so they're starting to come back, and it's amazing how many nations have stood up against the tiny nation of Israel and have failed. Israel's still there. The Jews are still prospering. Evil men like Adolf Hitler have come into the picture and specifically targeted Jews. That's not a coincidence. That's the direct work of Satan, manipulating a man. But yet they continue to prosper. They're the nation they are now. And God has followed through with his promise to make of thee a great nation, the national blessing for Israel. Then he says, and I will bless thee. This is a personal blessing, right? It's not just the nation that he would create afterwards, but he promises to bless Abraham himself. And we know that that comes true because Abraham is a very wealthy man. Abraham, in fact, his wealth is so great, and even those that are under him are so great, because Lot, as carnal a man as he was, got to reap some of the benefit and blessing just being around Abraham and just being near him. Abraham was able to accumulate wealth and prosperity. Was able to go into foreign nations like Egypt. And Egypt, the Pharaoh took notice that he was there. Right? He was not someone that just came in unnoticed. He had wealth. He had men and women, servants underneath him. He had a beautiful wife that was to be desired. And people took notice of Abraham because God blessed him. There's a personal blessing there. And those personal blessings continue. He says, and I will make thy name great. It's interesting. When you go through the patriarchs, to Isaac, to Jacob, to Joseph, all the way to Moses, who is it that they refer to God as? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. Even after all that time, it's still the God of Abraham, because he's the one that started. And that name continues to perpetuate and to go forward and forward. His name also becomes relevant in the afterlife. Where was it that souls went before Christ's crucifixion and resurrection? Where was the temporary holding place? Abraham's bosom. When he gets, skip over to Luke 16, it's not up on the screen, but when the rich man dies and in hell he lifts up his eyes, he knows where he's at and he knows the person that he's talking to. He lifts up his voice and says, Father Abraham. Abraham's name was great. And even to this day, we know the name Abraham. Little kids sing a song about Father Abraham. Had many sons, had Father Abraham. I am one of them, and so are you. So let's just praise the Lord. God made Abraham's name great. It's a well-known name. People know him. Then the last personal blessing, and thou shalt be a blessing. So not only would he receive the blessing from God, and not only would his name be great, but Abraham would also be a blessing to other people. I mentioned Lot already. Just by being near Abraham, Lot was able to receive a blessing and receive wealth and prosperity just from being near the person that God favored. So he was blessed. His name was great. He would bless others. These are personal blessings. And then he ends with three universal blessings. This has nothing to do with the nation of Israel itself, but anyone can partake of these blessings. And I will bless them that bless thee. Universal blessing. Follows that up with, and curse him that curseth thee. Lastly, and in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. God said, Abraham, not only am I going to make your nation that follows you great, not only am I going to make you great and your name known and people around you will be blessed, but anyone that comes into contact with you or with your descendants, if they bless you, I will bless them. If they curse you, I will curse them. And the last one is the most important blessing of all. And in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. How did that come to be? How did that specific blessing manifest itself? Through Jesus Christ. Through the child that came from the tribe of Judah in the lowly town of Bethlehem, Abraham's descendant, out of that, every family and every individual that has ever lived on the face of the earth has the opportunity of being blessed through the salvation of Jesus Christ. Universal blessings given to Abraham. So today, even today, believers are blessed in Abraham through their faith in Jesus Christ. Let's look at Galatians chapter 3, several verses. Galatians chapter 3, verses 6 through 14. Even as Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. All right, pause right here before we continue. Remember that when God is talking about the imputing of righteousness on a life, what we receive at salvation, he uses Abraham as the example. We are called the friends of God because Abraham was called the friend of God. And the same transition and miraculous salvation that occurred with Abraham is the same kind of thing that we receive as well. God imputes or places his righteousness onto us. And the illustration he uses is Abraham. Continue on verse 7. Know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same are the children of Abraham. But that no man is justified by the law in the sight of God, it is evident. For the just shall live by faith. And the law is not of faith, but the man that doeth them shall live in them. Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. And the scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith, preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all nations be blessed. So then, they which be of faith are blessed with faithful Abraham. For as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone that continueth not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. That the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. You see that even at the beginning, I love verse number 8, and the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith, preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all nations be blessed. We receive blessing, and we received Jesus Christ and the salvation that went to the Gentiles because of the faith of Abraham, because of the promise that God said, through thee, all nations will be blessed. Through thee, I am going to bring my only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. And the faith which you have shown in me is going to be the faith that everyone else will have to demonstrate. You see, Abraham was not under the law. We don't see the law until Moses, until Israel is already established as a nation. God gives them the law not to justify them, but to show them their need of a justifier. The law did not save them, but the faith that they put into the law was what saved them. They were saved by faith the same way that we are saved by faith, except their faith was demonstrated through a following of the law. Our faith is demonstrated through the acceptance of the perfect sacrifice of Jesus Christ. All beginning with one man, Abraham, who because he was obedient to God and because he showed faith in God, God gave him the universal blessing that we all get to partake of. In thee shall all nations of the earth be blessed. What a connection. Genesis chapter number 12, God's already saying, listen, Gentiles are getting it. Heathen are going to get it. That was something that even the disciples didn't know. Peter himself struggled with the idea that the Gentiles could receive the word of God. Understand, Abraham was a Gentile. God made him a Jew. He was a Hebrew, but there was no such thing as the Jewish nation at that point. It was a Gentile that God had chosen. Makes more sense when you see the verse that we are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a peculiar people, just as Abraham was, chosen, picked out among the millions of people that were on the earth. God blesses Abraham and his nation. Now, we need to understand that the church has not replaced Israel in God's scheme. Just because the Gentiles have now received the word of God and have received a blessing of Abraham does not mean that God has totally forsaken Israel. Romans chapter number 11 would be a good chapter. I'm not going to have time to read the whole thing, but we will mention it here in just a minute. But Romans chapter 11 is a very good picture of exactly how God is going to use Israel, the Gentile nation, or the bride of Christ, and then once again bring the focus and shift it back to the nation of Israel. So, church has not replaced Israel, nor does the church receive the promises given only to Israel. We do not receive the first several promises or blessings that were given to Abraham. We get to experience the last three because they're universal blessings. I will bless them that bless thee. I will curse them that curse thee. In thee shall all nations of the earth be blessed. The first ones, the national blessing, the personal blessing, has nothing to do with us. We don't get to claim that God is going to make our name great. We're not Joel Osteen, who says, as long as you do whatever you do, God's going to bless you and you're going to have everything that you could ever want. Right? We don't get to claim that promise or that blessing. We do get to claim the blessing of Jesus Christ, which was given. So the church is not replaced. We don't receive the promises that are given only to Israel, which, on a side note, is one of the reasons we need to rightly divide the word of truth. Because there are people that get into some doctrinal problems and heresies because they're trying to apply an Israel promise or an Israel chapter to themselves. You get into a lot of problems in the book of Matthew if you start to do that. Matthew was specifically written to the Jewish people. Now, we can learn from it and we can learn principles from it, but there are certain promises and there are certain prophecies that deal specifically with Israel that is not for us, which is why God says that we should rightly divide the word of truth. So keep that in your front pocket as well. Now, comes into something that we can do now. We must pray for peace in Jerusalem. That peace comes when the Prince of Peace arrives in Zion to rule and reign for 1,000 years. A couple references here. Romans chapter 11, verse 24 through 27. For if thou wert cut out of the olive tree, which is wild by nature, and wert grafted contrary to nature into a good olive tree, how much more shall these be which be the natural branches be grafted into their own olive tree? For I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery, lest ye should be wise in your own conceits. That blindness is in part is happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in. And so all Israel shall be saved, as it is written, there shall come out of Sion the deliverer, and shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob. For this is my covenant unto them, when I shall take away their sins. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. Very famous verse, one we like to quote a lot at Christmas time. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. It's interesting that we sing that song a lot and we use that song a lot. The us in that passage of Scripture is not necessarily Gentiles. Isaiah was a prophet to Israel. Unto Israel a child was born, their Messiah. Jesus is not, I don't want to get into a problem here, Jesus isn't our Messiah. The Messiah was a national Savior for Israel. He is our Savior. He is the Jews' Messiah. If you want to get into that, that's an interesting study to make, but he's only ever called Messiah when in reference to Jewish people. But to us, he's the Savior. But he was coming. He was prophesied that he would come and that he would bring peace to Israel. It's our job as a nation that is not Israel to support that nation. Again, what was one of the universal blessings? I will bless them that bless thee. Want to know one of the reasons that America has been blessed by God? Because America is the strongest ally of the nation of Israel. Or at least it has been in the past years. It's coming up a lot in today's day and age that America is starting to loosen its allyship with Israel. We just heard, a month ago when there were some of the airstrikes that were happening. Israel was shooting at or launching missiles at Hamas, which is a terrorist organization, right? And they had every right to defend themselves, right? But what was the outcry? It wasn't for Israel. It was for Palestine, the Palestinians, right? And again, I'm not showing hate, saying that you have to hate everyone that's a Palestinian, but there is something to be said for standing with Israel, standing with the nation that God favors. I will bless them that bless thee. It's one of the reasons we should pray for Israel and continue to stand with them. Even if our country does not, we should. Because they are God's chosen people. So those are the blessings that God gave Abraham. Seven of them. One national, three personal, and three universal blessings. The seven I wills from God to Abraham. It's interesting, you can compare those I wills with Isaiah chapter 14. Satan's five I wills of Isaiah 14 are self-serving. Here, God is promising to bless Abraham. The key principle that we will see throughout history is that Satan takes for himself, God gives to others. God gave Abraham seven blessings that would help Abraham. Those were his promises. Satan uses his I wills to exalt his own name. I will ascend into heaven. I will be like the Most High. I will exalt myself above the congregation and above the stars of heaven. It's all about Satan. It's all about him. God said, Abraham, I'm gonna do something for you. Very interesting. And that is going to be how Satan works throughout the rest of history. Satan does not care about you. Satan does not care about anyone. Satan cares about himself, ruling his kingdom, setting up his kingdom, defeating God's plan so that his plan can rule and reign. God, on the other hand, cares about his friends, cares about his children, and his promises are to us. Now, there's several pictures that I want us to see before we close. How am I doing on time? Not that great. So we want to look at some of these pictures. The first one is in verse 6 and 7. Notice that obedience is required. Starts off in 1 through 3, God gives the promise. It's the first time that we see the promises that are given in the seven I wills. So then we see the actual journey of Abraham. Starts in verse 4, but in verse 6 and 7 it says, And Abram passed through the land unto the place of Sichem, unto the plain of Moreh, and the Canaanite was then in the land. And the Lord appeared unto Abram and said, unto thy seed will I give this land. And there he built an altar unto the Lord who appeared unto him. And so there was no altar for Abram in Ur. There was no altar for Abram in Haran. You do not see an altar and you do not see the appearance of God until he makes it to Shechem. Bob, if you can, bring up that picture one more time, just so you guys have the visual aid. Sorry, this side. And out of the whole journey of Abraham, it's not until the last couple stops that we see God appear to Abraham, physically appear and stand before him. It's like the last 10% of the journey. Which means that 90% of the journey, there was no communication from God. There was communication at Ur when God told him to get thee up out of the land and move to the place where I'll tell you. God doesn't appear again until he gets to the place where he told him, in Shechem. Shechem is the place of burden or shoulder. It is at this place where Abraham is able to relieve that burden that was on him of the unknown, not knowing where he's going to go. The burden of that God had placed on him to go into the land which I would tell you, and I will make your name great and make you a great nation. That was quite the burden to be placed on Abraham's shoulders. And for 90% of the journey, he has to bear that burden with no help. I say no help, with no communication from God, no appearance to let him know that, hey, this is it. He doesn't get it till he arrives in Shechem, the place of burden or shoulder. It's interesting. Later on, I believe it's in Psalm. I should have had this verse up here. I apologize for not having it. But God talks about placing the burden on his shoulders, lifting us up on his shoulders. Matthew chapter 28, the Bible talks about, not 28, Matthew, I think it's 7, 28 through 30. God talks about, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for my yoke is easy, my burden is light. Abraham learned that at Shechem. When he was in the place, when he finally reached that place of complete obedience where he ended. This is the first appearance of God. There is no record of Abram receiving any further revelation until his call had been fully obeyed. That's in verse number 8. This results in verse 8. Abraham is in the land, that's Shechem, and now there is worship and living in the promises of God. So, when you're looking at this passage, understand that it's kind of going out of order. It's giving you the premise, verses 1 through 3, and then it starts into the journey of Abraham. And when he finally makes it to where he's supposed to be, God appears to him, reconfirms the covenant. I will make thee a great nation, the promise that was given. Abraham builds an altar in order to establish worship with God. Look at verse number 8. And he removed from thence unto a mountain on the east of Bethel, on the west and high on the east. And there he builded an altar unto the Lord and called upon the name of the Lord. And so Shechem is right there in between Bethel and High, and he's in the land that God had promised him. He's at the place where he was supposed to be. God appears, confirms the promise that he was given, making it all worth it. He builds an altar and worship to the God that had brought him there. Let's go back to the illustration that I said. If I was offering you that money to go to the place, right, that I told you, leave everything, and let's say that you had been traveling for a year, 2 years, and in that time, I never once called, I never once texted, I never once posted on social media that, hey, I've got this person who's doing something for me. Nothing. You heard nothing for me for years. Many of you would probably start to think, man, I've been played for a fool. Right? I'm not getting any money. I left my home and my family for no reason. This has been a giant waste of time. But then, when you're in the right place and you receive the call, you receive the text, and I say, all right, check your account. And there's the $1 billion. It's what you had been waiting for, the promise to be fulfilled. You'd be pretty grateful. You'd be pretty thankful. Right? In today's day and age, you'd be posting on social media about the great things that had happened. Abraham received the promise, received an appearance from God. Notice, not just a word from God, an appearance. This is a Christophany, a pre-appearance of Christ before his physical appearance here on the earth. Abraham got to see God and commune and talk with God. And in person, face to face, God reaffirms his promise with Abraham. There's a key to be taken away from this that I think a lot of Christians will miss out on. You will not receive more revelation from God until you obey what you have been given. This book that we have is the complete revealed Word of God. It is His revelation to us. And yet, how many believers and Christians leave it sitting on the shelf? Never opening it, never trying to claim the treasures and the scripture knowledge that Christ has given us. But they'll come to church and expect God to move them to receive that emotional high that some people get from going to church. But they never receive any real kind of purpose from God. They're the ones that will often call the pastor and say, Pastor, my prayers don't get answered, Pastor. I don't know what's happening. I don't get anything when I read the Bible. That's why I come to church. I don't read on my own because I just don't get it. I don't get anything. I don't understand what I'm reading. They don't open the Word of God. God's not going to reveal more to you until you've used the knowledge that you've already been given. I use this verse a lot in Timothy, or Peter, my bad, when he says, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue, knowledge. Why does virtue come first? Because virtue is doing what you know to do. He said, once you've received that, once you know the basics of your salvation and what you're supposed to be doing with it, then I can reveal more knowledge to you. The natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, because it's spiritually discerned. It doesn't necessarily mean a lost person. You can be a Christian and be a natural man, if that's the man that you serve. There are two sides, two natures within you, the old nature, the new nature. If you're serving the old nature and following the old nature, this book is not going to come alive to you. And you're going to sit back and say, man, I can't believe they pulled that out of the Bible. I'd have never seen that. It's because the natural man can't see it. But the spiritual man can understand because we have the Holy Ghost within us that reveals and teaches us all things concerning His Word. Abraham received the initial instruction and the initial promise. When he had obeyed, God gave him further instruction. God appeared to him, communed with Abraham. Abraham built an altar to remember the occasion and to worship God. You will not receive more revelation from God until you obey what you have. Romans chapter 1 is a great passage, but I have Psalm 19, 1 through 11. Very interesting passage of Scripture. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth His handiwork. Day unto day uttereth speech, and night unto night showeth knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. Their line is gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them hath He set a tabernacle for the sun, which is as a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, and rejoiceth as a strong man to run a race. His going forth is from the end of the heaven, and his circuit unto the ends of it, and there is nothing hid from the heat thereof. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. Now, don't miss the transition that was given here. He starts with a general revelation. The heavens declare the glory of God. The firmament showeth his handiwork. He's talking about creation revealing the existence of God. Does that for six verses. Transitions to the Word of God. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. That's a special revelation. That's God's actual words that he has given us. Converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord, again, the Word of God, is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord, again, the Word of God, are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eye. Again, the Word of God. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold, sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is thy servant warned, and in keeping of them there is great reward. I think this is one of my favorite passages of Scripture. Because I believe that God is trying to just build up. Have you ever had someone that's just trying to build up a story to get to the climax of it, and then it's like, oh man, that was so awesome. It's like, I wish you could have gotten there a little sooner, but that was an awesome story. God starts off with the most grand thing that we can think of, the universe. The heavens declare the glory of God. The firmament showeth his handiwork. Day unto day uttereth speech, and night into night showeth knowledge, right? Everything that we can see, the galaxies, the universe, the planets, the sun, the stars. How many of you have ever gone to a planetarium and they've shown you like a little box like that big on the Hubble telescope, and then they tell you each one of those dots is a galaxy. Not just a star, an entire galaxy. And they have it on the whole wall, the whole picture, but it's just a little square that's singled out, and all of that galaxies are in that. And when we think of how vast our universe is, how does God say he measured it? Span of his hand. How amazing that is. God's building this up, right? The heavens, the circuit of the sun, and it's like a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, rejoiceth as a strong man. His going forth is from the end of heaven and his circuit unto the ends of it. And there is nothing hid from the heat thereof. Everyone experiences the universe. Everyone alive experiences the sun and experiences the stars. Right? You can't get away from that. And he builds it all up to nail home what he actually wants us to understand. The Creator, everything that he's done. But it's his word, folks. The law of the Lord. First mention of the word. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The heavens don't convert the soul. God's word converts the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. So it's universe, universe, universe. It's so grand, so wonderful. But the important thing is my word. Only my word can change. Only my word can convert the soul and make the simple wise and enlighten the eyes. And only my word will last forever. The elements, the universe, they're going to melt away with a fervent heat. Notice what's important here. Verse 10, more to be desired are they, what? The words of God than gold. Yea, than much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb. There is nothing greater than the words and the promises of God. Nothing we see, nothing we can experience will be greater than the word of God that has been given to us, that has been revealed to us. The same word that was revealed to Abraham. The same God that gave him the promise. Verse number 11, the last verse. Moreover, by them is thy servant warned, and in keeping of them there is great reward. God's told us what happens when we don't follow the book, when we don't hearken to his words. There's judgment. But when you obey, when you follow after the revelation that has been given to you, there's reward. Abraham experienced that. He followed the voice of God and was rewarded through the promise of the nation of Israel. Leads me to Luke chapter 12, verse 48. To whom much is given, much is required. God has given us much. He's given us his completed word of God that we are to follow. We are to work and serve and read and delve into it and make it a part of us. But we're so concerned with everything else. We're more concerned with the job that we have. We're more concerned with the friends that we have. We're more concerned with the entertainment that surrounds us and that saturates our world that as it does today. And we're holding to this earth more than we're holding to God's word. That's why I brought in Romans chapter 1. Because what does it say about the generation in Romans 1? They serve and worship the creature more than the creator. They would rather hold to this earth. We have more people that are concerned with saving the earth and saving the planet rather than pleasing the one that created it. Abraham had that same challenge. Abraham had attachments here on the earth. But what did Abraham say about himself? This brings us to the second picture, and this is where I'm closing. In verse 8, God uses pilgrims. Now Abraham, in verse 8, is in a tent. He's a stranger and a pilgrim. Hebrews 11:13, these all died in faith, Abraham being one of them, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them and embraced them and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. What's the key thing about a pilgrim? He's not concerned with what he has. He's just passing through. Abraham realized, it's not about this world that I'm in. I'm going to hold on to the thing that's going to last. And that's the word of God. Everything else, I'm just passing through. We sing the song, this world is not my home. I'm just passing through. We need to have that mentality. Hold to the word of God. Hold to the law of the Lord, the statutes of the Lord, the commandments of the Lord. Everything else is going to pass away. Everything else is going to melt away in a fervent heat. All of our works, everything that we do here on this earth is going to burn up and be tried. It's either going to come forth gold, silver, precious stone, or it's going to come out wood, hay, and stubble. And unfortunately, the Christians that are too attached to this world, too attached to the creation, all their works are going to be wood, hay, and stubble. But for those that embrace the pilgrim life, choosing to hold on to God's words more than the things that surround them, there's reward for them. Gold, silver, precious stones, crowns that we'll be able to cast at Jesus' feet. The last slide I have, we must be strangers and pilgrims on the earth before acceptable worship is possible. 2 Corinthians 5:20 mentions that we are ambassadors of heaven to this world. God didn't choose Abraham just to make him a great man. He chose him to use Israel to bring glory to God. They were his chosen nation to be a light to the people around them. We are a chosen generation because we're ambassadors of God's word to a lost and dying world. How are we doing on that? Have we accepted the responsibility of the word of God that has been given? He's given us all the revelation that we require. And we will not be able to claim ignorance of this book. You're not going to be able to stand before God and say, oh, well, God, well, I didn't read the Bible, so I didn't know that I was supposed to do that. That's not going to cut it. To whom much is given, much is required. And in this book, God has made great knowledge of His Word and the importance of His Word. We cannot be ignorant of it. We must embrace a pilgrim's life, holding only to the book and being an ambassador to this world, drawing people closer to Him. Every head bowed, every eye closed. With heads bowed and eyes closed, we'll do the invitation this way. I think the purpose of the message was pretty clear. God's given us a responsibility. Just as He gave Abraham His word with a promise that followed, He's given us the same. He's given us the Bible, the Word of God, the perfect, inspired, inerrant, preserved Word of God. It's been revealed to us. Are we using it? Are we studying the Word of God? Is it more precious to us than fine gold? Is it sweeter to you than the sweetest thing that you can taste? The Bible mentions the honeycomb, the honey out of the honeycomb. Psalm 19, written by David, man after God's own heart, man possessing the key of David, which we've learned is a love for the Word of God. That's why David wrote that it's more to be desired than gold, yea, than fine gold. And it's sweeter than honey in the honeycomb. Is that your view of the Bible? Is that your view of God's Word? Do you read and dig into it and strive to live it? Or are you more concerned with the daily life that you lead? The job that you have, the friends that you have, the family that you have, the entertainment that you desire? Which holds more value to you? So we stand to our feet, heads bowed and eyes closed, the piano's going to play. Maybe God's spoken to your heart this evening about the priorities in your life. Abraham, because he had faith in the words of God, the Word of God, received the promise, received the blessing. Had he not obeyed, we would not be seeing the same thing written about Abraham that we do. What have you learned from his life? Is it just another book? Just another book that you can keep on the shelf, not read it, not understand it? It's not going to cut it when you stand before God, folks. To whom much is given, much is required. Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for the opportunity that you've given us to be in your house. Thank you for your word, and Lord, for the life of Abraham that we can learn from. And Lord, thank you most importantly for your word. Lord, I pray that we would have a love and a passion for the Word of God. Help us to daily be digging in and delving into the treasures that Scripture has. Lord, so that we may know you better, so that we can build our relationship with you. Lord, may your Word be more precious to us than anything that we can receive in this life. Lord, I pray that when we stand before you, we'll be able to stand before you and cast crowns at your feet. Not be ashamed because of a wasted life that we had on earth. Lord, we'll be quick to give you the praise, honor, and glory for what is accomplished in our lives. We love you. We thank you. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for being here this evening. Next week, we have our focus night. So please be here for that and stay faithful with your evangelism. And we look forward to a good night. Yes, sorry. We had some extra food from our teen trip, some bread, some lunch.